Hello, I'm Nick Pryke and you're watching Meet the Boss TV. In this programme, why the media and entertainment industry's content handling problems may just be coming to an end. Video is more popular and more available than ever before, so what's the problem? The same as with anything produced in volume, handling and workflow. At the business end, says Alex Grossman, VP for Big Data Product Marketing with Big Data Experts Quantum, if you can't find it, you can't sell it. So what are the biggest challenges the media and entertainment industry have to contend with when it comes to optimizing behind the scenes of monetized content?
I think the number one thing that people have to deal with is really producing content in a timely manner. Actually meeting deadlines and being able to have that content available for remonetization. So what I mean by that is essentially people today have to work with a number of different distribution points. And those distribution points vary greatly. They vary by frame size, they vary by format, and they vary by the actual content itself. So whether you're producing it on, say, regular terrestrial TV for broadcast, or you're producing it to go digitally on the web or some other digital distribution, since today we demand content on just about every device at every time, this on-demand and content zones that people are looking at, this production quality that people are looking at, really strains the idea of having your assets available every time that you need them. And often we're repurposing assets to produce content almost every day. And so people face this challenge of deadlines because usually the people who are asking for the content are saying, well, it's already digital. There's not a lot of work to do. You take it in digital, you reproduce it, and you output it digital. It's not like the old days when you had to take linear tape and bring it in, digitize it, and then put it back to tape. But what they don't realize is that workflows are actually more complex in a file-based manner than they were when things were just on tape.
Clearly what you're talking about here, and it's quite a nice part from, I pulled up from your UFC case study actually. Can you maybe run me through a little bit more about what you mean by content workflows not being linear but a round-trip process?
What happens with the UFC is that they do a four-hour event. They shoot it from up to 16 cameras and sometimes 50 different angles that they'll be shooting from, and they have to assemble that very quickly into something that they can get on the air. And when we talk about on the air, we're not just talking about terrestrial broadcast, cable, or satellite. We're talking about things like Xbox and PlayStation. Their audience is a younger audience, much more inclined to have a smartphone or a tablet close to them rather than sit down in front of the TV and watch the event. And they have to be able to assemble very compelling shorts and trailers to be able to bring people into the event. And then afterward, even though a lot of the events are broadcast live, they have to sell that content and they have to really promote their spokespeople, which are their fighters. So one of the things that's really interesting is that the UFC didn't start from a linear broadcasting perspective. What they did is they started completely nonlinear. They started as a file-based workflow. So they didn't have the challenge of taking legacy equipment and making it work with equipment they had today, but they didn't have anything. So they had to start completely. So in their case, what they were doing is they were looking at how do I take and how do I build a workflow that gives me the ability to not only quickly turn things around, but also to save them in a way for long-term preservation where I can instantly grab any single event footage that I need.
Content repurposing is one of the greatest opportunities for remonetization. And you clearly touched upon a few opportunities specific to the UFC there, but are there any other perhaps more top line or generic opportunities that better archiving can leverage when it comes to looking at remonetizing content?
Yeah, I think you really have to look at it this way. You have to be able to mine it. If you can't find it, you can't sell it. And content today often gets sold the first time around, but has growing value. And one of the problems that we find is that you never know what content is going to have what value in the future. So things that are valuable today may not be valuable in the future. Things that aren't as valuable today may be highly valuable in the future. And how do I know? I mean, you can't really throw it away. You have to be able to save a significant amount of content, and you have to be able to access it quickly. So you would think to yourself, well, if I had something like a media asset manager, it would take all the content, it would put the metadata around it, although you still need to do that. You have all the pertinent information around it so you can find it, and you just put it out there and you're going to get it. Well, that's only part of the story. The other part of the story is that you have to make sure that it's secure when it's out there and it's accessible. And so while a media asset manager can understand the idea that things are online and offline, you need an underlying infrastructure technology that brings that offline content back online and removes that online content into a more offline manner.
How does better archiving reduce those costs both internally and externally?
We get a lot of people that ask us all the time about why should I spend money archiving things that I may never use? Why should I have an archive that's easily accessible versus an archive that's, say, a deep vaulted storage? And we always say, well, you need both. You need to have archive. You need to be able to vault it away safely and mostly off-site. And you also need to have it close, because one of the efficiencies that we see is people actually being able to monetize content quickly. It not only takes the manpower that's used to be able to mine it, find it, and re-ingest it, as you would have to do in an off-site environment, but it also allows you to do work in a simultaneous manner. So, for instance, if you can do more work in the same amount of time because you have a good archive strategy, you've freed up your primary storage, you can actually have more people work on more jobs at the same time. So in this way, we can improve efficiency end-to-end in the content workflow, and we can also take a lot of the human error out of it, where people have to actually log and find the content because the content always exists on the nearline. So this more modern way of looking at it has a lower cost buy-in than buying primary storage, and over time you actually see reduced costs because you're not constantly migrating and constantly replacing the most costly piece of your workflow.
A report I found from Booz & Co. was showing that media companies are facing challenges in four major areas at the moment. Those four being complex processing, lack of technology integration, unclear organization models, and evolving industry standards. So I guess my last question to you would be, from the quantum perspective and or from your own subjective point of view, in what order would you prioritise those four challenges for the industry? Which do you see having the most impact over the next 12 months?
I think you're seeing these challenges in the industry constantly evolving in themselves. And what I mean by that is, if you look at the challenge of these lack of standards, which is the first one that I always have to look at. You know, the thing I love about standards, there's so many, just choose one. And these standards will evolve over time, and one of the areas where standards are changing is in both the distribution formats that we're seeing and the acquisition formats that we're seeing. People are constantly changing that, and we don't see that going away. We see it actually increasing. Recently, Ultra HD television was introduced. Yes, there's not a lot of content for it, and there's not an easy way to distribute it, but for sure, people will embrace it, and more smartphones and tablets have higher resolution displays and can work with higher resolution content. And so being able to produce that and being able to go to more distribution points is really the challenge. It affects the way you ingest or acquire content, because you want to keep it at the highest resolution, and you want to maintain it, your archive, at the highest resolution as well. And because of that, you're affected, knowing that the standards will change. You have to always be ready for those standards to change. That's probably number one on the list.
What role does quantum play for the industry as you move forward down that path?
Really, quantum are experts in being able to manage the end-to-end content workflows, being able to manage the storage infrastructure underneath. The way we tend to look at it is that the ingest or the content acquisition is really important, and the distribution of content is really important. And they bookend all the production and all the archive that sits underneath it. One thing that Quantum has done is they've built a file system, a way of actually managing the content end-to-end throughout, and built all the tools on top of that, the software tools to be able to manage the content so that you know where it is and you can acquire it very quickly. It's really a performance story with a management story on top of it. So we talk about open ecosystem. Quantum works with all the best of breed applications that are out there and has open APIs or programming interfaces that people can use to be able to manage this. Additionally, in the last few years, Quantum has built an infrastructure of hardware using appliances in the appliance model, common off-the-shelf hardware that uses Quantum software that manages everything from the file system and the metadata to the primary storage, the nearline storage, and even offline tape. So really, Quantum is the company that can do this end-to-end, and not only having the hardware and the software, but the professional services and the distribution channel using VARs worldwide to be able to manage this, to give customers the best experience that they can when building out content workflows, whether they're one of the largest broadcasters in the world, the largest post facilities in the world, or the smallest ones, or even in-house video.
For more fantastic interviews directly related to your business, be sure to explore Meet the Boss TV.